Loud. And then I'm going to switch screens to. Oh, come on. Where is the thing where you change the screen? Oh, here it is, share screen. Okay. Okay, you guys can see that okay? Thumbs up. Okay. Well, okay, just wanted to start off where we stopped last time to talk about topology optimization and load path optimization. And I just wanted to let you guys know, so today's going to be a fun lecture. So today, there's not going to be a lot of rigor in today's discussion. There's not going to be any math, really. It's just kind of a fun discussion about different strategies that have been employed through the years to reduce the weight of primary structures of cars and airplanes and motorcycles and things like this, bicycles. Before I go too far, I just want to comment real quick here. So last week, Tepe, if I hope I pronounce that right, mentioned another type of load path optimization. I think it was called HAC. He sent me a paper, which I read through, which is very interesting. And this is a type of topology optimization that is used or was developed specifically for the case of impact, designing a structure for impact safety. So the ability to absorb energy. And, you know, where topology optimization focuses a lot on minimizing the aggregate strain energy of the system to produce the lightest, stiffest structure possible, this method that Tepe sent me from this paper was a little bit different. It focused on making sure that the strain energy in every element was equal, okay? And then the authors would sort of set a threshold and said, okay, we want to make sure that all of the elements in the mesh that are in this packaging volume get to this point where they all have the same strain energy, and the strain energy that we're going to pick is some value. So the system actually works a lot more like the genetic search algorithm that I showed you, where it goes through and it calculates out the strain energy everything of every element in the mesh, and then it determines what sort of the gap between the target value that it wants to hit and the actual value that it's at. And then it starts assigning error functions if things are outside of constraints. So and it'll keep adjusting the density, just like with topology optimization, it'll keep adjusting the density to get to the point where all the elements have the same equal strain energy. And then the very laboriously, the algorithm that they use goes through and it uses time steps. So it deforms the mesh a little bit, like it would an impact, and then it recalculates. And then it absorbs, then it deforms it a little bit further, then it recalculates. And it keeps doing these time steps until, I guess, it's reached some level of crush that's acceptable from a passenger safety perspective. But it's very, like I said, it was very targeted specifically at being used to develop energy absorbent structures rather than necessarily lightweight structures. And they showed some interesting examples of how the structure would look at using sort of a conventional topology optimization like I've shown you and versus what theirs would look like. And it actually was different. So interesting stuff. Does that explain the Tepe? Does that explain it? Does that make
yeah.
sense?
Yeah, I finally understand. Thank you so much.
Yeah, my pleasure. Okay, so having said that, let's move on here. So topology optimization, we talked about load path optimization. We looked at this Audi structure here. And here's our geometry materials. And I wanted to show you some interesting ways that load paths have been structured in various vehicles. Here's an example that seems to be very effective in a lot of different types of vehicles, and that's using the engine as the primary structure. And long ago, I would have thought this was sort of the domain of Formula One cars, but actually it turns out that tractors, farm tractors, like this 1917 Fordson Model F here, also use the engine as a structural member. I got this picture off the internet, but actually the way I discovered this was I was at an ice cream stand many years ago in Concord, Massachusetts. And for some reason, they had some old tractor on display at this ice cream stand. And I noticed that they had used the engine as a structural member. So looking over here, you can see, you know, here's the engine, this gray thing, and then there's some live axle for the rear and some axle for the front. And this engine and transmission combination, this gray piece right here, is the primary structure. The driver's actually sitting on a little post that comes off of the transmission casing. And then all of the bending load and all the torsion load is supported by the engine. It wasn't until 1969 that Lotus Formula One adopted the same idea in the Lotus 49. And I'm going to talk about this a little bit further in a couple of slides, but here's the engine. This is a V8 engine. And then you can see there's this green tube. It's an aluminum monocoque structure, actually. I'll describe what that is in a minute. But the rear suspension bolts directly to the transmission casing, thereby putting the engine under both bending and torsion loads. Interesting, huh? So this saves you the weight from having to put a bunch of heavy structure off the back that would then support the suspension. The engine's being used for two things here. It's being used to propel the car to provide power, and it's being used to support the rear of the vehicle. They have some tubes coming down here. These diagonal tubes, these are just to support the roll cage, which was, well, basically useless anyway, because it probably really wasn't strong enough to save anybody. The driver's head was sticking up above it anyway, so it didn't really matter. It's kind of really an ornament, really. I don't think it really saved anybody's life, but there was probably somebody who convinced themselves that it did, so they put it on there. But this was very revolutionary. This is the, like I said, 1969. This is the first Formula One car to use the engine as a structural member. And this has been, ever since 1969, pretty much every Formula One car, I could say with confidence, like every Formula One car uses the same strategy to a different degree today, and every Formula One car in between, because you're using that one structure. You're making sure that there's no superfluous mass, that everything is being used for multiple functions. this is same strategy is used on a lot of Ducati motorcycles. Some other motorcycles too, but I just happened to pick up this picture of Ducati. This is it's actually my friend's motorcycle. It lives in Germany. You can see this is what it looks like with the bodywork on. And here's what it looks like with the bodywork taken off. And you can see the engine is this V engine right here. I think it's a V4. You can see it right there. And the rear suspension control arm, which is on the other side of this wheel, it's over here, actually bolts directly into the casing for the transmission. Okay, and the forks bolt to this truss frame, or this sort of space frame structure, that then bolts to the engine. But the important thing to realize here is that because the weight is down, right, and the driver's sitting right here, the rider's sitting right here, there's a net bending load on the engine. So the engine structure not only is there to contain combustion, you know, gases and rapid expansions to propel the vehicle, but it also is in bending, so it supports the vehicle. Therefore, you're using the structure of this engine twice, so to speak, and it turns into a lighter solution. This motorcycle is, I think, about 350 pounds. That's pretty light. It won't feel like a bicycle, but for a motorcycle, that's pretty light. Here's a kind of a modern interpretation of all this. BMW sells electric scooters. I don't know if they're just selling them in Europe. I don't know if they're selling them here or in Asia, but BMW makes these electric scooters. And this is what it looks like with the bodywork on, and this is what it looks like with the bodywork off. The structure you see here, this kind of really bricky looking structure, this is actually the battery of the vehicle. Okay, so there's a little electric motor right here, I think. I think there's a drive band right here. And the battery pack, which is made out of cast aluminum, becomes the primary structure of the vehicle. And the rear suspension is bolted directly to this casing, as is this sort of space frame structure that holds up the forks. Oops, I need to do that. So again, they're using this structure here twice. They're using it the first time to support the load of the batteries, which is pretty heavy, to protect the batteries from external, I don't know, moisture, impacts, whatever. And then they're also using it in bending as the primary reaction member in this motorcycle or the scooter. This battery pack is actually under bending. Pretty clever, I think. Any questions about this, guys? We're good?
Quick question.
Yeah.
So What is usually the safety factor that's put into the design when you're trying to minimize all of these?
Right. So typically with these sort of things, stiffness becomes the driving factor. Typically, I'm not saying 100%. I know that for a fact. That's what's happened here. But typically, meeting the strength requirements of a big primary structure like this is met long before you meet the stiffness requirements. Okay, so the amount of structure you need in order to stop a battery from ending up on the street outside the motorcycle, you meet at a much smaller size than you do the stiffness. Okay, so the point I'm getting at is the factor of safety from the strength factor of safety is probably really high. I mean, it could be like, 1.5 to 2 maybe. And that's what BMW in this case had to do in order to meet the stiffness requirements. And the stiffness requirements, like I've mentioned before, they relate to the way the vehicle feels, the so-called NVH, noise, vibration, harshness. If the structure's not stiff enough, it can be very difficult to ride or scary to ride because it won't necessarily behave predictably when it comes to steering around things. So that's why the stiffness is so important. Does that make sense? Thumbs up? Okay, great. Okay, so a little historical perspective here. I'd like to, in case you guys don't know this gentleman already, fortunately he's not with us anymore, this is Colin Chapman. Colin Chapman was the founder of Lotus Cars. So the Formula One I showed you a couple slides back, you may have seen the Lotus Esprit in some James Bond movies, the Lotus Elise, my favorite car. These are the cars that Lotus made. Lotus was extremely successful in Formula One. They won many constructors' championships, many drivers' championships. I think Ferrari is still more successful than they are, but that might just be because they were at it a lot longer. So Colin Chapman was born in 1928, and he started right after World War II at the age of 17 at University College in London. He actually studied civil engineering, or actually structural engineering, not necessarily like aerospace engineering or mechanical or materials, but actually they didn't have materials back then. He joined the Royal Air Force after World War II for about a year. He worked at British Aluminum for a couple years. And then in 1952, he does something crazy and he finds Lotus Cars. At the time, they called it Lotus Engineering Company Limited. In 1970, he was awarded the honor of being Order of the British Empire, Commander of the Order of the British Empire by Queen Elizabeth. He is hands down the genius pioneer of lightweighting and automotive structures. It wasn't Enzo Ferrari who really came up with the things that really were big innovations. Enzo Ferrari was a very conservative man when it came to engineering. He wasn't an engineer actually. But Colin Chapman really was the guy who pushed the limit, and I would say in many ways defined the modern Grand Prix car. His philosophies were interesting, and you see these quoted a lot in the car magazines about every component must serve multiple functions. So I just showed you an engine that the structure not only serves as an engine, but it also serves as the support for the back of the car. It's got two functions. I was once at a race, kind of in the middle of Michigan somewhere, at Groton Raceway, and there was a guy who was racing a little Lotus Formula Ford, and he had the bodywork off, and I made the mistake of touching one of the tubes from this space frame that it was made out of. It's this tube structure that the primary structure was made out of. And I burned my hand, because what Colin Chapman had done is he had put the heating or the cooling fluid that goes into the engine through the tubes to the radiator. So rather than having a separate sort of a radiator hose, he decided to use the steel that the frame was made out of. And so there's a great example of where there's something that had multiple functions. It had heating. It was acting as a radiator tube. It was also acting as the primary structure for the car. So that's a classic example of his use a structure for more than one application. He really invented the McPherson strut suspension, or also the Chapman strut suspension, which is pretty much on every car or most cars on the road today. His philosophy was always about, instead of worrying about adding so much power, add lightness to the vehicle. So back in the early 50s, when he was racing in Formula One, the Ferraris and the Maseratis of the day were so focused on power that they had these big, heavy cars and they would make these enormous heavy engines, and then Colin Chapman showed up with his Lotuses, and they were these tiny little fragile little cars with these tiny little engines putting out a quarter of the horsepower of these big monster Ferraris and Maseratis. And yet he was able to beat them on the track because it was lightness that really mattered. And I can tell you from my own experience going to being involved with racing that you hear about power so much, you know, like the Bugatti Veyron and the 700 horsepower, this or that. But when you're really out on the track, it's really interesting to see how lightweight cars can be so much more competitive than cars with lots of horsepower, with big heavy engines that have lots of horsepower. So he was the first person to come up with the idea of using a monocoque structure, and I'll describe what that is in the next slide. In Formula One, he was the first guy to come up with using the engine as a stressed member in Formula One. I don't actually know if he was inspired by tractors. It could be he was. It could be that he just sort of came up with the idea, like this would make sense. We could use this structure for two things. He was the first guy to put a mid-engine monocoque car in Indianapolis, and he won the Indianapolis 500 the first time he was out there. Cleaned the track up of all these cars that had been evolved over decades. Pissed off a lot of people in the Midwest, I'm sure. He was the guy to really see the potential of aerodynamics to make Formula One cars or racing cars go faster by adding things like wings and diffusers on the bottom of the car to produce downforce that would give the car more traction in the corners. He was the first guy to ever put these so-called ground effects and wings onto a Formula One car. In the mid-80s, he was the first, Lotus was the first company to ever put active suspension. Actually, I think it was early 80s. Active suspension in a Formula One car. It was very slow and not as good as some of the systems today, like on the Mercedes G-Class, but he was the first person to ever do that. He was also the first person to ever really use composite materials, so fiberglass, in production cars and in cars for the street. So all of these things are huge contributions to the automotive world and lightweighting. And unfortunately, he died of a heart attack when he was only like 54 years old. He got involved with John DeLorean. I don't know if you guys are probably not old enough to know about DeLoreans. If you've ever seen the movie Back to the Future, you've probably seen the DeLorean. But there was a whole thing that went on there. There was a scandal with misuse of money and illegal drugs. And I think he probably caused him a heart attack, and he died, unfortunately, 53. But Lotus is still in business. They recently got bought by Geely. I'm not sure how you say it, a Chinese company. And I think they're going to have a great comeback. I'm really excited. They're my favorite car. So any questions about Colin Chapman? We're good? Okay, remember, Colin Chapman defined the modern Grand Prix car, defined lightweighting, defined a lot of the stuff I'm talking about. He was really the brains behind a lot of these things that have made cars lighter and stronger today. Okay, so the first place in the literature that I've ever been able to find information about attempts at lightweighting came from this guy, Mitchell. And Mitchell, I'm pretty sure, was somehow involved with balloons. A lot of the early efforts were trying to find ways to make lighter gondolas for balloons so the balloons could go higher up in the air and people could see, you know, better views and things. There was a lot of competition back then about who could go the highest in a balloon. So Mitchell came up with this, or proposed this idea of what became the space frame. His idea was that you would have, you know, any structure that was supporting some external load would have all these tiny little, small little tubes that were joined together. And he came up with these kind of structures like you see in the middle of the page here. And this became the true space frame. That there were certain sort of assumptions, like in order to calculate the stress in this tube, you got to make sure that it's not in bending, it's only tension or compression. It's a little hard to understand here since some of these tubes are curved, but his work in 1904 became the basis for the space frame. And this space frame concept has really, in a very pure way, has only really been put to use in racing cars or production cars only a couple of times. And the most interesting example is is this car right here. Let me see if I can make this bigger so you can see it. This is a late 50s, early 60s. Maserati so-called birdcage, a type 61. They called it a birdcage because it had so many tubes that the discussion was is that if you put a bird in there, it wouldn't be able to find its way out. It'd be a birdcage. And you can see the structure right here. This is the car. This is what the structure looks like. But you can see all these tiny little mess of tubes right here. Okay. this car was actually fairly successful for its day. But okay, so you can begin to think then of the primary structure for vehicles as something being somewhere on a spectrum. On one end of the spectrum, you have the pure space frame. On the other end of the spectrum, you have what we call a monocoque, which is kind of like this egg here. So the space frame, conceptually, so theoretically, philosophically, is a collection of small tubes, typically smaller diameter tubes, that are joined at nodes. These nodes are, like I said, philosophically, these nodes the nodes are not, they don't fix the position of the tube in angularly. So the tubes philosophically can rotate. Point being is that in order, by doing this, what happens is the tubes become under only pure tension or pure compression. That's a pure space frame concept. That's the idea, that the tubes are only ever see a pure tensile or a pure compressive load. And if these tubes were constrained at the nodes between them, then philosophically they could rotate, if they were constrained so they couldn't rotate, then philosophically they could be under bending or torsion. So these types of structures are, I think, more popular really in architecture than they are for cars. Even back in the, you know, back in the 50s when people tried to make racing cars out of this, and streetcars too, like the Mercedes Gullwing. The original Gullwing was close to a space frame. These types of structures are very good for handling so-called point loads. So if you have a suspension component, or you have some discrete load that you need to react, then you can use these nodes as a place to input those loads. Okay. On the other end of the spectrum, we have what's called a pure monocoque. Okay, so the egg, you know, an egg is like a pure monocoque design. It exists in nature, and it's a so-called stressed skin design. The skin itself is actually in a pure, you know, philosophical monocoque. The skin itself is actually under a tensile and compressive load at the same time, depending on what side of the skin you're looking at. These type of structures are not good at holding, or they're very bad at holding point loads. I mean, anybody who's ever, you know, dropped an egg off a building in one of those egg drop contests and had the egg smash all over the place, or maybe, jammed a fork into it or something and saw the egg crack, knows that these structures don't handle point loads very well. But if you have a chicken sitting on top of it where the load is very well distributed over the surface of the egg, they're pretty good. You know, they react those loads very well when the loads are very highly distributed. So these types of loads, or these types of structures, are oftentimes really good in airplanes, because airplanes generally have sort of very distributed loads. They've got some wings. The wings are kind of big and chunky, and the mounts are kind of wide, so you can distribute that load over the fuselage. The fuselage is very close to a pure monocoque structure. And then I always like to ask the question, because I tend to think in terms of spectrums, like what's in between these two? What type of structures are between these two? Because in reality, when you really design a car or an airplane or a tractor or a building, or parts of a spaceship, it's very hard to build a pure space frame structure. It's very hard to get there. And same thing with a monocoque. You always have to attach something to your primary structure, whether it's suspension or wings or seats or something. There's always some need where the pure monocoque's not going to work. So what are some things in between? So for example, like a skeleton, like, you know, the three of us have, is that a space frame? Okay. Maybe parts, maybe your arms are sort of like under tension or compression, or I don't know enough about muscles and how muscles react loads on bones and things, but there could be some bending loads that come from the muscle attachment on your bones and things. One of these days, I'm going to take some time and learn more about this. I'm kind of squeamish when it comes to blood and guts, but there's probably a lot to learn, because evolution, development of organic structures, they have, you know, millions of years, maybe hundreds of millions of years to get it right. And a lot of times there's some pretty interesting things you can learn from the way nature solves structural problems. Okay, so next thing we're gonna do here is we're gonna play a little game. So I've just described you what a monocoque is and what a space frame is. You guys have any questions? Do you understand the difference? Thumbs up? Tepe, thumbs up, okay. So we've got six structures here and we're gonna play a game and you guys are gonna go off mute and we're gonna go through all six of these and you're gonna tell me if you think it's a monocoque or a space frame, okay? So first, number one, this is a Bucky dome. So there was a guy named Edminster Bucky or Buckminster Fuller or something like that. He designed these very beautiful geodesic domes for housing people and things. He sold houses that look like this, smaller, of course. There might even be some of these at MIT, I think. Would you think this is a space frame or a monocoque?
Space frame.
Tepe, agree?
Yeah, space frame.
Agreed, that's a space frame. Okay, here is a very early wooden airplane where the fuselage was made out of these planks of wood that were glued together, somehow joined. And it's got these big wings that feed these wide distributed loads into this wooden fuselage. So, space frame or monocoque?
Monocoque?
I think this would be the in-between because, like you can see with the landing gear, there's some components there that's definitely more space frame.
Okay, well this frame, this structure is often referred to when people talk about monocoques, that this is a very pure form of a monocoque. But I do see your point. You're totally right that there's some point loading coming from this landing gear. But a lot of people look at this as a monocoque. Okay, here is one of our hero Elon Musk's SpaceX rockets. There's a rocket motor at the bottom here. And then this whole thing is filled up with fuel from top to bottom. The structure is basically just these stainless steel plates around the perimeter. Monocoque or space frame?
Space frame.
Monocoque.
Monocoque.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Here on number four, here is a Lamborghini Aventador. This is a, whatever, $400,000 carbon fiber beauty. It's a beautiful piece of engineering. There's no question. It doesn't get the best gas mileage. It's not best for the environment, and it's not made of much steel, but it's beautiful. Okay. Monocoque or space frame?
It's tough because there's definitely four point loads from where the wheels connect to the frame, but
so I'm going to call this one both because there's like a carbon fiber center cell here and the outer surfaces, the surfaces, I call them the class A surfaces, the surfaces that you see when you just walk up to the car in a parking lot. These structures are load bearing. They're made of carbon fiber and they're load bearing. So the center cell has some components of a classic monocoque. But at the same time, they've bolted these sort of space frame structures off the front and back. So these are definitely space frames, or they're kind of somewhere in between. They're kind of somewhere in between because the joints here don't rotate. So in certain loading conditions, these tubes will most definitely be under bending and not just pure tension or compression. Okay, number five, the truss bridge. I just killed it, sorry. In between. The truss bridge, there are some joints on here that are held together by bolted plates. So some places like where the tubes kind of triangulate in a corner, there's actually like a plate that sits in there and it has bolts on it that go to the tubes. So this looks like a space frame and it's pretty close to a pure space frame structure. And I'm sure when they did the stress analysis on this bridge before they had good finite element analysis, they assumed that those plates weren't there and that these tubes could rotate and would only be in tension or compression. Okay, but it's much easier to do the stress calculation by hand if you assume that that this is a pure space frame. Steel, okay, final example. Number six is a giant racing bicycle frame. It is made out of carbon fiber. I might have described this to you before. They have female molds. They have some silicone, I think, or probably silicone mandrels that expand when they heat up. that are the shape of the inside of the tubes. They cover these mandrels with carbon fiber, with little pieces of prepreg. They have many, 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 many little pieces that they very, very, very carefully put on top of these silicone molds, these sort of male molds, and they stick that whole thing inside the female mold, and then they heat it up, and the silicone expands, the carbon fiber gets pressed into the female walls of the mold, and then eventually it cures, and you have an incredibly stiff, lightweight structure. This structure here is probably less than a kilogram. Monocoque, in between, or space frame.
Space frame?
Tepe?
In between?
In between. So why, you know why it's in between?
It's hard to explain.
Because the tubes can't rotate from where they're mounted. They have these big, beautiful radii between the tubes. See that?
Mm-hmm.
And what that does is it reduces the stress concentration. So they can then thin out the walls dramatically to reduce weight. And I would bet that, I think I mentioned this, might have mentioned this before, every cross-section of this tube, and all seven of these tubes, each cross-section has been put through a shape optimizing algorithm. Like I showed you before, where they put the perturbation vectors on the surface and then they move the surface of the tube around till they minimize the aggregate strain energy. So I call this a mid-spectrum design because it's definitely not a monocoque, because you can see it sort of has these discrete tubes, but it's definitely not a space frame because the tubes can't articulate. The tubes see bending and torsion loads in addition to tensile and compression loads. So therefore it can't be a space frame. But these are often called monocoques in the bicycle magazines, but they're really not. Okay, so just wanted to go through this. I wanted to show you this. This is just for fun, okay? But I wanted to show you here. Like here is sort of a history going from the 70s to just about now of bicycle frames and how they've developed in those nearly 50 years. So starting in 1970, the Tour de France was won by bicycles that looked pretty much like this. This is made by an Italian company called Colnago. The tubes themselves are round in cross section for the most part. There's some oval sections in the back in here, if you can see my cursor, and in the forks, but the main primary structure tubes here, these three tubes here, are round in cross section. And they're made from a chrome molybdenum alloy. And this is a great example of where the material has been, for the day, has been optimized. So chrome alloy was kind of an exotic thing back in the early 70s. And at the same time, the geometry was optimized via vis-a-vis the thickness of the walls, okay? These tubes are joined together using a sort of fabricated lug structure, kind of a joint, and then they're brazed in there using brass solder. In 1973, Teledyne built the first titanium frame. The titanium was probably, I don't know if all the information, was probably a commercially pure titanium. It probably wasn't that stiff. The tubes really weren't much bigger diameter than a steel frame, although titanium has 2/3 the Young's modulus of steel. This frame was probably a wet noodle. It probably was not a lot of fun to ride because it probably was not stiff enough. And it probably wasn't even that light. They welded this thing together, like a nice TIG weld, tungsten arc gas welding. It was exotic, and I think there was some people who raced on these successfully, but they probably weren't the greatest performer. In 1975, in another Italian company called Mazzi, took the same concept as Colnago here in the 70s, but instead of having a fabricated lug, they cast them using investment casting techniques. And this was kind of a big deal for the day. And that this idea or this structural concept of using chrome moly tubes with investment cast lugs, that sort of persisted till about 1990 as the primary way in which racing bicycles were made. In 1977, Exxon and Graftech joined up to make the first carbon fiber bicycle frame over here. It was also a wet noodle, wasn't very stiff, and the tubes were joined together using adhesive and aluminum lugs. in the late 70s, a company called Reynolds, which is a British company that makes tubing. I think that they originally got their start making steel bottles for climbing, for holding oxygen for people who climb Mount Everest. So little pressure vessels that could hold oxygen. And they, in the late 70s, they came up with the idea of using a heat-treated chrome moly. I'm sorry, I take that back. It was a heat-treated chrome manganese that they used for these tubes. And because it was heat-treated, if you were to weld these together, you would lose the strength of the tube because you would destroy the heat treatment. So, or even if you braze them with brass, the temperatures would be too high and you would lose the heat treatment. And then the tube wall thicknesses were so thin that it would probably fail if you lost that strength. So it was required by Reynolds to braze this frame together using silver solder because silver has a much lower melting temperature than brass. The carbon fiber frame, whoops, the carbon fiber bicycle frame went, I think, more mainstream in the mid-80s. This French company called Vitus, I'm not sure how you say it, they went back to using the carbon fiber lug structure. So the design they came up with was very similar to the Exxon GravTech bike. Carbon fiber tubes that were probably commercially available, they could probably buy these tubes by, I don't know, probably buy them when they were 30, 40 feet long or whatever, several meters long, and then cut them up and make them into this frame. And they use aluminum cast lugs that they then use the structural adhesive to glue the tubes to. A good friend of mine I used to bicycle race with had this exact frame, and he went out for a sprint one day and tore the bottom bracket out. So the joint right here, the adhesive failed. This was not a real successful design. Some of them are still around, but then it was the bike wasn't very stiff. It wasn't even that light. It was kind of you could do better with steel back then. So here's the 1985 Klein aluminum. So Gary Klein was an MIT graduate, like you guys will be soon. And I think after he graduated MIT, he started this bicycle company using aluminum. He understood mechanical properties very well because he, rather than some of these other attempts that went before this of making aluminum frames, he had the idea of using these big diameter tubes. So there he went back to this idea of materials and geometry. He used aluminum because it had a lower specific stiffness than steel. And he knew the tubes were under bending, so he could use that bending and use that bending design for stiffness scenario, which means that you can get a lot of good weight savings in aluminum. And these bikes were a little bit lighter than the steel bikes at the time, not dramatically so, maybe a pound or two, but they had these big diameter aluminum tubes that gave them their characteristic look. And then later, Cannondale actually copied these. I don't know if you guys know Cannondale bicycles, but they actually copied this. I don't know if there was a lawsuit or anything between the companies, but there probably was. In 1986, the first carbon fiber one-piece frame came out that was molded, like the giant frame I showed you in the previous slide by Kestrel. I think they were in Santa Cruz, and they eventually got bought by Trek, I think, and they don't exist anymore, really. In the late 80s, Merlin, which actually is another Massachusetts company down here, they made the first sort of popular titanium frames, and they had various versions. They had three main versions. One was made out of a commercially pure titanium that had bigger tubes, bigger, fatter diameter tubes that wasn't that light and wasn't that stiff. They had one that was made out of the 325 titanium alloy, which was better. And then the most expensive one was the 6-4 titanium frame. And these frames were maybe not the stiffest, but they did have a weight reduction, which was good. The thing that's really nice about these frames is they basically last forever because they don't corrode. They're made out of titanium. And then they join the tubes using tungsten arc gas welding, which is, if any of you guys ever seen one of these bikes, they're beautiful. This frame, this company Merlin, I think they disappeared, but in a roundabout sense, they became Seven Cycles, which is now in Watertown. So Seven Cycles, which is, I guess, founded by the original guy, one of the welders at Merlin. And he's, I think he lives in Medford or something. He's a Massachusetts guy. You know, he has this company, they're making these frames in Watertown. In the early 2000s or mid 2000s, the Taiwanese company Giant, they sort of took this idea of Kestrel and they made it better. And they started producing their TCR advanced SL, frames, which, I think are amazing. Taiwan has become a very popular place for building bicycles. I think a good percentage of the world's bicycles must be made in Taiwan at this point. Tepe, maybe you can correct me here. I don't think there's a lot of Japanese manufacturers right now that are still producing in Japan. I mean, I think Shimano, they make parts and they're Japanese, but I don't know if there's any big frame makers. I mean, when I was back in the day, I remember there was a company called Three Rensho, probably saying that wrong, Three Rensho, which was Japanese. They made beautiful, beautiful steel frames, but I don't know if there's anyone left in Japan really making bicycles anymore. Tell me if I'm wrong. No? Okay.
I'm not sure, sorry.
Yeah. I don't know if there's any big steel manufacturers or bicycle frame manufacturers in Japan anymore. In 2015, around 2015, maybe a little bit earlier, there's this company, Reynolds again, the company over here, that made this bike out of chrome manganese, heat-treated chrome manganese tubes. They went on to continue developing steel for bicycle applications. They saw that their market was being taken over by carbon fiber, and they said, what can we do further with steel? And they developed a stainless steel that's what's called a marging stainless steel. So this bike is heat treated in such a way that it begins to precipitate martensite probably an austenite or a ferrite matrix. So it's a stainless steel bike. It's probably, since there's so much chrome, it's probably austenitic. It's probably austenite with islands of martensite in it. But this is sort of the phase strengthening that we talked about, I think, in the first or second day of our lecture. They've gone a long way to develop these materials that have incredibly high strength. I think the strength of the steel that they use in this frame right here is on the order, I think the yield strength on the order of like 1.2 gigapascals. So whereas the strength of the chrome moly frames back in the 70s was maybe about a yield strength of like 0.6 gigapascals, this is 1.2, so like twice as strong the material. And I think steel is still a good material to make a bicycle frame out of, if anything, because it's more durable. It can take loads in more directions without getting, you know, permanently damaged. A carbon fiber frame rides great as long as you're just bike riding it. But the second something happens that you don't expect it, like it falls on a pole or something the wrong way, and you get loading transverse to the fiber layup direction, you can get a failure. And I've seen it happen before. So carbon fiber frames are great, you know, as long as nothing bad happens to them. If you, you know, over the course of a bike, if you hold onto a bike for 10, 20, 30 years, like I have, 40 years even, the chance of something bad happening in those 40 years is highly likely. So I don't really know what the durability or long-term viability is of these carbon fiber frames. It'll be interesting to see, but the steel frames offer much better. The problem with steel bicycle frames is that until just recently, nobody has really, really tried to take advantage of the geometry side of it. So there's a lot of companies that have really, like Columbus and Reynolds, they've really pushed the material side of this by developing alloys that are stainless so they don't need to be painted, that are high strength so they can go to thinner and thinner walls. I mean, the top tube on this guy is maybe 300 microns thick, the wall thickness. So they've done a lot on the material side, but they really haven't, really in my mind, they really haven't addressed the geometry side. So going back to our paradigm of materials and geometry, this frame here is a classic example of where they really have only focused on one side of that. And the result is this bike is still 1 to 2 pounds heavier than a carbon fiber bike. Interestingly, in 2019, ThyssenKrupp, Thyssen is a big German steel company. That's like the big state-owned German steel company. They actually, I think, understood this, that the frames in the, you know, that are winning in international competition are carbon fiber, and they used to be steel, and they lost that market, and they actually moved to counter that. They made this frame that you see here. So this frame looks like it's carbon fiber. This one in the lower right here, this one right here, it looks like it's carbon fiber, but this is actually made out of steel. It's a dual phase steel. It's got, I think, austenite or ferrite and martensite in it. And the yield strength is about 0.7 gigapascals or 0.8 gigapascals. And what they've done here is they've stamped out these two shells, okay? They stamped out these two shells, and then they put them together, and they laser weld around the perimeter to hold the tubes together. And I don't know, I've come perilously close to buying one of these, so you might see one of these in the future. the infinite corridor someday. But the frames are still a little bit heavy. This bike is on the order of, you know, maybe like 18 pounds, where some of the carbon fiber frames are 12 to 16 pounds, the whole bike. So they got a ways to go. But I applaud the effort, because somebody actually took the time to, or company actually put the resources into addressing not just the material side, but the geometry side as well. And because of that, I think this bike is a success, because this is the first time anybody's really, really gone at it and tried to make, to fulfill both sides of that equation, geometry and materials. Any bicycle frame questions, guys? Nope. Sheboygan? Nope, okay. So we're almost out of time here, but we can keep going through some of these until we run out of time here. I wanted to give some examples of some lightweight car designs, since we've been talking about cars too. Some of these cars are, I've already discussed. The Lotus, the 1957 Lotus Elite, is the closest to a full monocoque, a pure monocoque, that I think any production passenger car has ever gotten to. And the way Colin Chapman made this frame is that he made these three big pieces of fiberglass. These were actually made by Bristol Aircraft in England. And they made these gigantic molds, and they made these parts out of fiberglass. And then they had a couple little metal inserts to handle or to react the point loads from the suspension or the windshield. And then they glued these three pieces together, and they made these big cavities in between that provided pretty decent stiffness. These cars were very light. These cars are tiny. They're actually smaller than a Miata, than a Mazda Miata, one of the greatest cars in production today. These are significantly smaller than a Miata, but they weigh about 1,400 pounds. So they're very, very light. They're very, 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 very fragile. These cars are known for having problems with the suspension punching through the fiberglass, and then you got to find some way to fix that. I personally think that this car, in a lot of ways, from a structural purity of structure perspective, has never been matched in a production street car. I think it's a beautiful car too, and it's interesting. It was designed by an accountant, not by an actual designer. I came perilously close to buying one of these in about 2003. I wish I had, because they went up in value very quickly afterwards. But really, really gorgeous car. We already talked about the Maserati Birdcage, the Type 61, and the closest to a pure space frame with all these tiny little tubes welded together. The Lotus 25, this was the first monocoque structure in a Formula One car. It was aluminum. The aluminum parts were riveted together like an aircraft at the time. And the primary load was taken up by sort of this half tube here. The Lotus 49, I already mentioned, this was the first production car or first racing car to ever use the engine as a stress member. Talked about that one before. I'd love to look at this picture here. This is a Porsche 917 on the upper right here, upper left, sorry. The upper right here. So this structure right here, this is the Porsche 917. If any of you have ever seen the movie Le Mans with Steve McQueen, this is the car he raced. And the tubes were very small. They were very light. They were made of aluminum. This structure was on the hairy edge, I think, of even stiffness. So we talked before, Sheboygan, about factor of safety. Like this car, probably they barely met the factor of safety. I mean, they had a 1.0001 factor of safety on this thing. It wasn't very stiff. Lots of drivers got killed in this car, because if you hit something, like, it would just collapse and kill the driver. There was this, your feet were sticking out in front of the front wheels. Very, very sketchy design. But Porsche won a lot of races with this car, because they had this enormous, I think it was even a flat 16 engine in here, made of a magnesium block. Beautiful car. Wouldn't want to drive one. Probably not very safe. Wouldn't want to race one. The McLaren came up with the first carbon fiber monocoque in the early 80s, the 1981, the MP4-1. This is the carbon fiber tub, so-called tub structure that they used. This was the first time anyone ever did this. Since this car, pretty much every Formula One car since has had a carbon fiber tub like this. They've obviously gotten a lot better at it in terms of using better carbon fiber, consolidating the fibers better. more efficient geometries. There's this, you can see there's this huge stress concentration right here. The Porsche 962 dominated Le Mans for many, many years. This is an aluminum structure, very similar to the Lotus 25. Aluminum panels that were riveted together with honeycomb in between. My favorite streetcar, the Lotus Elise right here. They made this, I think I talked about this frame before, they made this frame using aluminum extrusions that were joined together using adhesive rather than using welding, because they were able to maintain or preserve the inherent strength of the tube. Do you guys want to stop? I think we're past the time. I got one more slide here I can show you, and then we can stop, unless you want to stop right now.
I'm fine with one more slide.
Okay. Tepe, you too? One more slide? Okay. In the early, in 2000, BMW came out with the Z8. This was a very interesting structure. I don't think it was a real efficient use of materials, because frames were made out of aluminum, that extruded aluminum that was welded together, so they really lost a lot of strength with this structure. But I like to show students the structure, because they're very, very clean load paths. You see, you can very clearly see, like, here's the rails, the front rails, here's the bumper. You can see how they very nicely fork the load path right here, this junction right here, into an inner rail and an outer rail. A very, very clean design. The Porsche 2006 Cayman, maybe nothing so special, but just a really nicely executed steel body structure where you can see they used high strength steel in the primary load pass and these rail structures and door beams and so forth. And they used some aluminum closure panels. I always used to say that you don't need to use high strength steel or carbon fiber to keep out the wind and the water, right? You don't need that. You don't need that mechanical capability. So why pay for it? Why have it there? Consequently, I'm a big fan of these multi-material structures where you have something that doesn't have a lot of strength as a closeout panel. The Porsche Carrera GT, I talked about this car on the first day. This is an incredible structure made out of carbon fiber. There's a carbon fiber tub, and then bolted to the back is this sort of quasi mid-spectrum space frame monocoque carbon fiber structure in the back here. And this is the first time I've ever seen this in a production car. This structure here, I would say, is very similar to the Giant Racing Bicycle. It's probably not made as well in terms of consolidating the carbon fibers with no porosity in between, no pores in between the layers, but it's a similar idea. And then we've already talked about the Audi A8. And it's made of a wonderful combination of aluminum extrusions, castings, and plates, or sheets. Very pretty efficient structure, although it's not necessarily that much lighter than an S-Class Mercedes, which is about the, about the same size. We should probably stop there. You guys have any questions? We can talk more about this next week, but any more questions? No? Tepe?
Okay, I'm okay.
You're good? Okay. Okay, good, guys. So next week's the last lecture. We're going to go through a couple more slides here on designing materials and absorbing energy and examples of these body structures that are made very nicely out of monocoques and space frames and, in between those two extremes. And we'll talk some more next week.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Have a good week.
Thank you.
Cheers.